name is Kaylie and Costa. I'm a third year PhD student at the University of Florida, and today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about optimizing mass spectrometry workflows to promote coral resilience in restoration. So while mass spectrometry might seem like a weird thing to be talking about at a coral conference, it can actually provide a lot of intel for coral resilience and also coral restoration. For example, it can help us further characterize environments looking at different chemical or biological contaminants. It can help us do things like visualize the interactions between different coral colonies or between corals and their symbionts. It can also give us a better understanding of coral physiology. So looking into their diet or reproductive cycles or their reaction to various stressors can give us important information that can help fuel some of these models that we've been hearing about this morning. And so when you start working with mass spectrometry with a new species, opening up mass spectrometry to things like corals is just now really taking off. You need to look at how you're making your workflow best fit for your species or for the tissue that you're looking at. So everything from how you're collecting your sample all the way through to the different instrumental workflows that you're using. And especially with coral, we need to consider maybe looking into identifying new compounds and adding those to our libraries to improve coverage. So one thing I'm going to focus on today is normalization. Normalization is basically whatever you're dividing the amount of the compound you're getting back from the mass spec by to get the concentration in your original sample. And so for different tissues and organisms, we use things like wet weight or dry weight, or intrinsic factors like DNA or protein or metabolites to basically make sure that any results that we're seeing are a result of the stressor that we're looking at, not of just there being more sample in your vial when you're doing these assays. So corals provide us this really unique matrix that doesn't fully work with all of these different normalization methods. Corals have tissue, which is where most of the biological compounds are found, but they also have skeleton that's made mostly of calcium carbonate and only less than 1% of their biological molecules. So how do we make sure that when maybe we grind these corals into a powder to do extractions for mass spec, we're not diluting certain samples with part of the coral skeleton? So to do this, I took coral fragments. I separated them using a water pick into the skeleton and the tissue. Then I made dry powders of each of these substances and combined them in 9 levels to create kind of corals in vials that had more skeleton rather compared to their tissue ratio. And then I could run these on a CO2 coulometer and look at the percent calcium carbonate in each of these samples. And what we saw was that using this method to quantify calcium carbonate gave us a fairly tight linear relationship. As you can see in this graph, how much skeleton we put in the vial correlated with the percent calcium carbonate reading we got back from the CO2 coulometer, with a fairly good R-squared close to 1 and a low standard error. And so to check our linear model, I had a colleague create 8 unknown vials with random amounts of skeleton compared to tissue powder. And as you can see, 7 of these 8 orange dots representing those unknown samples fell within a 95% prediction interval. So this is a fairly good way of looking at how much calcium carbonate is in each of our tissue samples. And we can use this when doing future mass spec projects to look into making sure we're normalizing in the best way possible. So maybe using some kind of combination of wet weight and percent calcium carbonate. And so the plan is to use this on future studies to look into how different environmental stressors cause sublethal impacts in corals, looking at things like red tide and oxybenzone-containing sunscreen. So basically, as we run these things through the instrument, we'll take the time to make sure we're accounting for the skeletal matrix. And with that, I'd like to thank everyone that helped with this project at the University of Florida, as well as Moat Marine Lab, and take any questions.
Yes,
So I started running these assays looking at stressors like red tide and sunscreen, and we were seeing bigger differences in our control groups that we couldn't really account for by just looking at the sample prep. And so I started looking at different things, and I found the skeletal to tissue ratio, and I was like, oh my goodness, we've missed a big part. And there's actually a lot of people out there kind of trying to figure out how best to normalize data in new tissue types. And so I think it's really important that as a field we can kind of get on the same page and make sure that we're normalizing in the best way so that we can really identify the impacts of these stressors to inform things like models and coral restoration.